morning, good morning, good morning. It is so good to be here with you this morning. You ever have one of those days that everything from the beginning, just seems to conspire, against you to get your back pushed up the wall, to distract you from whatever? That's been this morning. But, God is good, and we're just not going to play the distracting game. We're going to be what God has called us to be and do what God has called us to do. And right now, that is to be together in the Word of God. It is so good to be here with each and every one of you. And I looked up there and saw that my buddy and Julia were the first on again this morning. You guys, you're right on the spot. I'll tell you, what do you need to sit there? I like to see that. Buddy, I pray you're feeling good. I'm praying things are going well with you. Pray for you all the time, every day, buddy. I love you. I miss seeing you, but I sure am glad that you're here with us. And there's Miss Donna. She came up next. God bless you, Donna. And Alyssa with her three wonderful children. Good morning. I had so many good conversations about legalism and formalistic living. God has given us all we need in His Word. That's right. That's right. And, Paul says that legalism kills, but the Spirit gives life. And there's a balance. There's a balance between legalism and licentious living, license, if you will. And it seems like we're constantly pushing that pendulum one way or another. But if we just stay balanced, and this is part of what Solomon's trying to teach us, isn't it? How to maintain balance in this section. In our walk with Christ, we find that balance. When in wisdom and humility, we come to Him and we trust Him, knowing He's sovereign and He's over every part of our life. All right, Miss Sherry, good morning, dear friends. I love you too, my dear. We get together twice today. That's right, 6 o'clock this evening for our evening service. Miss Helen, God bless you. It's good to see you there this morning. And there's Terry, Miss Terry. Go, glorious day. I love that song. I do. I love the original. That was Miss Ethel's favorite song. All five verses of it is beautiful, but it is a long song, but it is a beautiful song. Now, with kind of a new twist put on it, it's just called Glorious Day. And Miss Carolyn, I'm glad you are up and around. I love seeing you Sunday. I'm glad you're feeling better. It's been a tough couple of weeks for you. And I just praise God that things have settled down and you're doing well. Miss Sue, good morning to you. It's always great to see you. You're out there. Well, as we kind of get up and moving, let's kind of flow into our lesson today. Because as we continue going through Ecclesiastes chapter 7, Solomon continues to develop the theme of the necessity of wisdom. We've looked at what wisdom means and what wisdom is, and now we're looking at how wisdom is developed in our life. Humility is the doorway that leads us into wisdom, because humility recognizes our need and our dependency upon God. Humility keeps us mindful of who we are. Therefore, we avoid thinking too highly of ourselves, being too righteous, getting over here on that legalistic ledge, or it leads us away from license that we're going to look at today. Humility keeps us mindful of where we are, helps us to keep balance in our life, in our living, and gives us the ability to lean solely upon Christ. Because as Alyssa said out there this morning, God has given us all we need in His Word. Doesn't He? Everything is there that we can lean upon Him. He guides us and leads us through it. It's a gateway to God's greatest blessings of grace, is it not? Paul write, it was James, for God resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. Humility allows us to see the sovereign hand of God in all of our life circumstances. whether it's the blessing of prosperity or the blessing of adversity. Remember verses 13 and 14 from yesterday. The word consider is used there twice. First, for the work of God, and then what we need to consider for an adversity. He says, consider the work of God. Consider the work of God, for who is able to straighten what he has bent? In the day of prosperity, be happy. But in the day of adversity, consider again. God has made, he's made one, prosperity, as well as the other, adversity, so that man will not discover anything that will be after him. In other words, so that man will lean completely and totally upon him. So yesterday we spent our time examining this other aspect. Humility avoids legalism, and discipline avoids license. Good morning, Miss Laura. So glad to see you out there this morning. Verses 15 through 18, and we'll be back in those verses in a little bit, says this: I have seen everything during my lifetime of futility. My lifetime of running out, trying to find net worth, or chasing the wind. All of these things that he's talked about in the first few chapters of Ecclesiastes. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there's a wicked man who prolongs his life in wickedness. Good morning, Miss Ruth. I saw that name pop up there. God bless. Verse 16, do not be excessively righteous. In other words, you know, don't get over here in all of this self-righteousness, puffing yourself up, and do not be overly wise in your own estimation. You know, they get you over here on this legalism side. Why should you ruin yourself? Verse 17, though, says something different. It says, do not be excessively wicked, and do not be a fool. Why should you die before your time? It's good that you grasp one thing and also let go of the other. For the one who fears God, the one who has wisdom, comes forth with both. In other words, he comes back into balance, all right? He's not way out here on one edge or way out here on the other. He comes here in balance, all right? Yesterday, we discovered some interesting things about the first half of that topic, and humility avoids legalism. So today, after prayer, we're going to move in and explore that second half, that discipline avoids license. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you have assembled our family together, that we can sit around the banquet table of your word and feed upon you. We so desperately need to hear from you today, to get a word that buries itself within our heart. To go through a day and not learn more of God is such a loss, but to come and begin our days, Lord, looking at you, looking toward you, feasting upon you, learning of you, and going away with just a little bit more understanding of who our God is, with yet something else to apply within our life or to readjust our life around. We thank you for that. It's a privilege and honor. Lord, this medium is a gift from you. It can be used so wickedly and horribly in so many cases, but in other cases, it can be used for the sake of righteousness. Now, we ask, Lord, that you take us in this time, and that, Lord, you anoint this teacher with some understanding that it can't be words for me that people hear. We desperately need to hear your word, what you are saying to us, both the speaker and the hearers, Lord. So let us come and open our hearts to receive your word this morning. In Jesus' name, we plead before the throne and say, amen and amen. All right. I hope you can all hear me well. I know my voice sounds a little raspy today, and that's because it is. It gets better one day, and then I'm back to being raspy the next. So who knows? You know, we'll just go with it, all right? Not only are we not to be greatly righteous or wicked, overly so, but we're also not to be overly or greatly wicked and foolish. So why does Solomon say, don't be greatly wicked, instead of just saying, don't be wicked? You know, think about that. Is it okay to be a little wicked? Well, let's figure that out. In order to answer the question, we've got to recognize a couple of things. First of all, Solomon is giving us two extremes. Remember that. When you look at that passage, you have to be able to see that, or you're going to miss what Solomon is saying. Legalism on one extreme and license on the other. And so when you look at that, you can respond to verses 15 and 16 by saying, if righteousness doesn't guarantee long life, I might as well just go out and live it up. You know, if I'm not going to live long, let me get as much life into my living as I can. So Solomon says, no, you know, don't go out and live it up. That's not the solution. Don't be excessively, overly, greatly wicked. Don't be foolish. You know, it's interesting because, second, we got to recognize that Solomon's focus in this section is on the depravity of man. If anyone is a sinner, as verse 20 says, we looked at that yesterday, then I can't possibly be perfect. But I should avoid wickedness as much as possible. Finally, we should recognize that Solomon doesn't qualify foolishness. We aren't to be excessively wicked, but we aren't to be foolish at all. In other words, to go on that route is the epitome of foolishness. So if I'm going to go down the route of living it up because, gee, I might not be here tomorrow, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow I might die, then you're being foolish. And he said, so don't even entertain that foolish idea. You may as well die. You may well die before your time. Verse 17 gives us this. It says, do not be excessively wicked, and do not be a fool. Why should you die before your time? Now, I think that's kind of a fascinating statement because it proves the principle that Solomon contradicted way back in verse 15. Well, way back. You know, we hit it a couple of days ago. And it still often holds true to today. Listen to 15. I have seen everything during my lifetime of futility. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness. There's a wicked man who prolongs his life in his wickedness. So he's seen it, and you and I have seen it. We've seen righteous people who perished young in life while still in their righteousness, if you will. And we've seen wicked men extended life doing wicked things all of their life, and they prosper. And we get a little irritated at that. We see people who are constantly making a killing out of their evil deeds. So we have to understand it's not that God's principles and promises mean nothing. It's just that they cannot be interpreted in some mechanical, legalistic, or licentious way. You know, it's really difficult to be disciplined and serious about holiness, but also humble and gracious. Now, in my life, I've dealt with this. There have been times I've realized that I've become spiritually lazy. And in that laxness, the first thing that usually ends up happening is my quiet time with God is what suffers. How about you? Well, the first places that you can see spiritual lackness begin to take place is in your time alone with God, in prayer, you know, and in these areas. So what I do, especially in my early years, I'd pull out my 59-59 or my 29-29, my prayer journals, from different conferences that I went to or whatever, and I would determine to discipline myself to do better. And boy, I'd set my calendar, boy, and my alarm, everything was precise. Boy, I got it all down. And I would check it all off my little checklist. How many of you have a checklist? You'll think, you know, it's interesting that, you know, all your life you're told you need to do this and you need to, you know, well, Mike, you need to spend 2 hours in prayer every day. Well, you know, that's great. Sometimes, you know, I've been known to do that, you know, several times. But it's mechanical. All the time you're spending, sometimes you're looking at your watch. Have I got my full 2 hours in yet? Well, not really. I still got 30 seconds, so I'm back at it. My alarm goes off. Okay, I check that off for the day. You know, that's the way legalism drives us to spend our life. So I begin to develop this legalistic structure, and it isn't long before I see this critical spirit coming up in me, the spirit of pride that says, hey, I'm checking off all the boxes every day. Look at me, Lord, right? Well, there may be some of you out there that have shared that same sort of thing in life. That's because we begin concentrating on the wrong things. Our eye is on checking off the boxes at that point, legalism. And our eye isn't on God. And I find those times when I realize that and I pull back and I give it to God, and instead of my focus and my quiet time being on checking off the boxes, it's on my relationship with God. Sometimes my prayer time could go 15 minutes and it was the richest thing in the world. Sometimes a half hour. Occasionally as much as 2 or 3 hours. But it's in that relationship that it grows, and time flies. You don't look at your watch. In fact, you know, I don't want to see a clock. And before you know it, when you know it's time to leave that place with God, time has flown by. I started learning that as I started to learn how to look at the Word, read the Word, and pray the Word. All of a sudden, this dialogue is going on, and God's doing most of the talking, and I'm responding to Him. Those are the sweetest days of balance that I find in my life. And there may be others of you that, because you've been told all your life, you have to be a good Christian, you got to do this, and you got to do this, and you got to do this. And you ain't doing this, you ain't a good Christian. I think God's more interested in our relationship with Him than every box that we could ever check off in our life. Think also that this is a key to balance, is it not? Maintaining both discipline and humility. Now, we're not to discount discipline. Paul says, I beat my body. In other words, I discipline myself so that at the end of it, you know, but what he means by this, he says, I discipline myself so that at the end I'm not disqualified. What he means by this is, you know, I keep myself focused upon God. And sometimes I have to force myself to come back to that and say, God, let me see you. Humility accepts God's plan. Discipline stops to consider it. Humility avoids legalism. Discipline avoids license. And then this one. Discipline pursues growth. Humility confesses failure and limitations. Look at verse 19. It's also a proverbial statement. Wisdom strengthens a wise man more than 10 rulers who are in the city. Think about that one for a minute. Wisdom strengthens a wise man more than 10 rulers who are in a city. I bet you that Cam and Karen Cody have a pretty good understanding of what that means. is very simply put. In other words, one man with biblical wisdom, one man who looks to God, one man who seeks to mold his life around Christ, one man who allows the Word to conform him, one man, one woman, one person, one wise person is more powerful than 10 shrewd politicians. Rather, a child or a teenager with the wisdom that they can acquire in their life through the Word of God, they're sharper, more alert to what the world is really like around them than 10 shrewd, and that word could be also manipulative or crooked politicians. Solomon expands and expounds this proverb more in chapter 9, and we'll look at it more when we get there, but let me just share with you a few verses, starting in verse 13 of the ninth chapter. Also this I came to see as wisdom under the sun, and it impressed me. There was a small city with a few men in it, and a great king came to it, surrounded it, and constructed large siege works against it. But there was found in it a poor wise man, and he delivered the city by his wisdom. Yet no one remembered that poor man. So I said, wisdom is better than strength. But the wisdom of the poor man is despised, and his words are not heeded. The words of the wise heard in quietness is better than the shouting of a ruler among fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much. Sorry, I left off a word. Much good. So we'll be coming back at this and hitting it head on when we get to chapter 9, which we'll be moving into before the end of this week. No, we'll be moving into 8. Anyway, wisdom is powerful. Powerful, powerful tool that God places in the heart and the lives of those who trust him. Even if wise men are sometimes ignored or forgotten, wisdom is still powerful. So how are we supposed to apply this proverb? Well, I think I can give you two words that you can write in bold letters. When you say, how do I apply? Just simply this way. Pursue wisdom. Chase after it. Look for it. Hunt for it. It's a valuable treasure in the life of the believer. If wisdom is so powerful, then by all means, we ought to seek more, to be more and more wise. That's what Solomon sought in his life. He was out there looking for wisdom in all kinds of different places. He'd already asked God to give him wisdom as it related to his judgment of men and leading the nation. But he needed this deeper wisdom that comes from God. If wisdom is so powerful, we need to seek it. Because it doesn't happen by accident. It does take effort. It does take work. We just don't sit around with our fingers folded in a funny fashion and our legs crossed in a lotus position going, oh, 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 thinking that wisdom is just going to flow into us like water flows, and soaks up in paper or whatever. It doesn't happen that way. You pursue wisdom. You see, it takes effort. It takes discipline. It doesn't happen by accident. Just like it takes discipline to consider the work of God and avoid licentious living, it takes discipline to pursue wisdom. But wisdom is worth every effort that you and I could ever put into it. It just takes discipline to consider the works of God and avoid license. It takes discipline to pursue wisdom. It takes discipline to surrender fully to God in a way that moves us from legalism. It takes discipline to stay balanced. But wisdom is worth the effort. So we ought to pursue growth in this area. Let me ask you a question. Let's go back a couple of years. Are you wiser today than you were in January 1, 2020? Have you grown in your biblical wisdom over the past couple of years? Years that have tested us and tried us, put our back against the walls in some ways. I hope that none of us have gone backward. You see, it's easy when the world is pushing against us the way the last couple of years have. And not just us, but all people. But, you know, we, in particular, we've seen attacks upon the church. All of these things pushing us. Sometimes we give in to the push. But I pray we have not gone backwards. I pray that you can honestly look, you know, in the mirror and look to God and say, I know by the grace of God, I am wiser today. I know more about God. I live more like His Word tells me to live today than I did 2 years ago. Part of pursuing holiness is pursuing wisdom. But like I said earlier, it's easy while pursuing wisdom to get a little smug and to look down on others. That's where verse 20 comes in. I mentioned it earlier. Now take a look at verse 20. Indeed, there is not a righteous man on earth who continually does good and who never sins. Discipline pursues growth. Humility confesses failure. How do you feel when you fail? Sweep it under the carpet? Or get it out before God and let him cleanse it away? How many just men are on the earth? How many righteous are out there? If you said zero, you're absolutely right. None. But wait a minute. Doesn't that contradict what Solomon says in verse 15 when he says, I've seen the righteous die in their righteousness and the wicked prolong their life in their wickedness and so forth? Solomon talks about the just man as if those kind of people actually exist. So how can he say there is no one that's just? Well, simply because there are people who have declared a righteousness by God on the basis of faith, and are more righteous than the unbeliever in a comparative sense. But no one is perfectly righteous. You see, I am not, and you are not, if you're a believer, a perfectly righteous person. Now, you have been made perfectly righteous. Well, I know. Okay. Here comes the confusion. It should really, if we, you know, I think this is a theology that we ought to have down and nailed. Jesus Christ went to the cross, the righteous for the unrighteous, okay, that he might bring us to God, correct? There upon the cross, he who knew no sin was made sin in our behalf, correct? For what reason? That we might be made the righteousness of God. How? Not in ourselves, but in Christ. So when you gave your life to Christ, you became righteous, even like Christ is righteous. You have been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So when the Father looks at us, even with our sin-stained life as a believer, even with all the failures that have happened to us since we became a believer, he sees us as perfectly righteous as his Son is perfectly righteous. However, in practicality, we are to live out that righteousness, live out your salvation in fear and trembling, work out what's been put in. All right? He has made us righteous. Now we are to work out, we are to live out that righteousness before the world. Some days, not too bad at it. Some days, we stink at it, right? One moment, we'll be walking in righteous, demonstrating the life of Christ, and it's just free-flowing, and the next minute, somebody cuts us off in traffic, and we're no longer practicing righteousness. correct? Does that make sense? So in the one sense, yes, we are perfectly righteous because we've been made that in a very real sense by God. We are made holy. We are made righteous. But we may not be living holy. We may not be acting righteously on the practical side of things. All right? So in one sense, we are. But in the sense that Solomon's talking about here, there is none righteous, no, not one. Sound like Paul? Yeah, just a little bit in Romans chapter 3. You won't find a fully righteous person on earth, not in the practicality, not in practice. We are to pursue righteousness. We are to live righteously. But we understand that in us is this old dead man, this old nature that continually seeks to rise up and regain control of our life after we come to Christ. This is why Paul can say in Romans 6, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you would obey it in its lusts. Rather yield yourself and the members of your body as instruments of righteousness unto God. All right? Who are we yielding to? You see, there are people who are declared righteous by God on the basis of faith, and are more righteous than others who have not yet accepted Christ. But on a practical level, no one on earth is perfectly righteous. And there was only one man that ever lived in perfect righteousness, and that's Christ. We call this the doctrine of total depravity, and it revolutionizes the way we view the world. For instance, in verses 21 and 22, the next thing that Solomon says is, also do not take seriously all the words which are spoken to you, so that you will not hear your servant cursing you. For you also have realized that you likewise have many times cursed others. Ooh! Don't you love it when a scripture author, one of the people that God uses to pen his word, tap dances on your feet? What's the command in verse 21? Don't pay attention to everything people say. You know? Don't eavesdrop on conversations. Don't want to hear what you're not going to want to hear. Why? Because you might overhear your servant cursing you. You might overhear somebody saying bad things about you. Ever have that happen to you? You tell me, scripture isn't relevant. And how would that make you feel? Think back at times that you got a word that, well, so-and-so said this about you. Oh, this I hear this all the time. Well, I never met you, never knew you, but I heard people talk about you. I didn't think I was going to like you. That makes you feel really kind of icky, I think. Discouraged, mad, hurt, sorrow. That sting of rejection, right? Like, hey, I never mistreated that guy. How dare he say things like this about me? I remember years ago, and, well, there's a couple of people out there, you'd remember the incident, where I was accused of running around on my wife. You know what the basis of the accusation was? An individual saw me before I headed to the hospital to see one of our precious members who had been taken to the hospitals on a Wednesday night. And they had been in my office talking with me. And I got the phone call that this person was being rushed to the hospital. At the time, Woody was my associate. He was still with us. And I called him real quick and asked if he could take the evening service because I was headed to the hospital. Well, I excused myself from them and they seemed to be fine with it. But I did something odd, I guess, for them. I grabbed my toothbrush and toothpaste and rushed down to the the restroom, brushed my teeth, and came back, and out the door I went. Within a couple of weeks, there's this rumor circulating and going around about me. And when it was traced back and when it was investigated and looked at, the individual said, well, I didn't believe he was going to the hospital. They said, why? I said, well, who washes their teeth before they go to the hospital? I want my stinky breath to get in the way. Brush my teeth sometimes before I go to the service. You get what I mean? When I heard that, when that word came back, I'd have been better off never hearing it. It hurt. It hurt. It caused me to laugh later on, but it hurt because of the ridiculousness of it. But it hurt because my reputation was being tarnished because I brushed my teeth. But isn't that life? Isn't that the word? Doesn't the word tell us that? Isn't that the world we live in? Solomon said, you'd be better, you got to learn to ignore some of the things that people say. Why? Now here's the blow. Here's the stomp on the toe. Because you know you've done the same thing to someone else. When I saw that, I'm looking and saying, boy, I can remember a lot of times in my life I said something pretty nasty about somebody. I was as guilty as the person who spread rumors about me. I was as guilty of having done the same thing. How many of you have ever passed on or shared you were upset or angry at somebody and you said something about them you wish you could take back? And of course, you can't take those things back, can you? Once they're out there, they're out there. So understand, you know, we have selective memories. We just do. We get all bent out of shape when someone says something mean about us, but we forget that sometimes we've also said mean things about other people. You see, we're all in the same boat. So be humble. Recognize that you've done it too. Learn to ignore the unhelpful criticism that comes your way. But not only does humility confess its failures, it confesses its limitations. In verse 23 through 25, it says, I tested all this with wisdom and said, I will be wise, but it was far from me. Identify with that? What has been is remote and exceedingly mysterious. Who can discover it? Verse 25, I directed my mind to know, to investigate, and to seek wisdom and an explanation, and to know the evil of folly and the foolishness of madness. This verse we'll have to pick up on tomorrow morning. It says these verses remind us how determined Solomon was to be wise. He made himself a laboratory experiment and chose to live for money. He chose to do that, see if there was net worth there, chose pleasure to see if there was net worth there. He literally put himself in the position of pursuing this thing. At the end of his life, he comes up. Understand that it was foolishness, evil, falling. I directed my mind to know, to investigate and seek wisdom and an explanation, and to know the evil of folly and the foolishness of madness. These verses remind us how determined Solomon was to find wisdom and the lengths he went to find it. He says in verse 33, I will be wise. And he determined to accomplish it. Sometimes he looked in the wrong places. Ultimately, he found it in the only place there is to find true wisdom. Will you pray with me? Do you understand this? Is it helpful? I pray it is. Let me hear from you sometime and what God is doing in your life. I appreciate every time I hear back how God is shaping and molding his people for his glory. Father, I want to thank you so much thank you from the bottom of my heart how much you love us and how patient you are with us to let us, to lead us, really, to direct us. Even when we're going around the wrong path, you're there like a like the good shepherd, or I could even say the sheepdog that nips at our heels, turning us and bringing us back into the way that we ought to be. Thank you for that. Thank you for never leaving us, never forsaking us, but always, always leading us on to growth and understanding. Now, Lord, I pray that you take your word and bury it deep in our heart and make what we've heard today very real to us and help us to see it vividly in technicolor and understand it and apply it to our life. You are gracious, good, and greatly, greatly to be praised. To you be all the glory now, Lord. Here we are today, your servants, to go out and do whatever it is that you have called us to do today. Give us eyes that we can see where you're at, ears to hear you at work, and let us jump in with both feet and join you in that moment. Thank you, Father. Praise you in Jesus' blessed name. Amen and amen. God bless. God bless each and every one of you. Terry says, absolutely. Oh, you guys are so precious. So good. And I pray God is able to just really pour blessing upon blessing upon blessing. Because there is blessing anytime we get into the Word. And when we all get into it together, it's wonderful. Oh, may God enrich you today and use you powerfully for His purposes. God bless. See you tonight at 6 o'clock. Then tomorrow morning, we'll be right back here at 9. God bless.